Welcome to Agent of Wealth Podcast with Marc Bautis from Bautis Financial. In this podcast, Marc helps small business owners and retirees overcome the multiple wealth planning challenges involved in your financial life. We do this by creating comprehensive wealth management plans to guide you towards financial freedom, ensure you never run out of money, and help create a balance in life that prioritizes what is most important to you. Join us for this journey as Marc draws from years of expertise and guest experts to solve the multiple wealth planning issues involved in your financial life.
Hello and welcome to the Agent of Wealth with Marc Bautis of Bautis Financial. Today we're going to be answering one question in this podcast. Well, I'm sure we'll answer lots of questions, but the main question we're going to answer is, what issues should I consider before I retire? Good morning, Marc. How are you?
Good morning, Eric. I'm great. How are you?
Doing fantastic. That's a big question.
It definitely is. And, you know, when you make that decision or start thinking about that decision to retire, it's a difficult decision. It's emotional. So the more planning you do, I think it'll really help out and make that decision or make that transition have as little stress as possible doing it. Yeah. And how we're going to answer it, we're going to look at it as a 37-point checklist of things to think about or issues to look at prior to retirement.
Wow, that's a big checklist.
Yeah. And it is a big checklist, but like I said, it's a big decision. So, and there is a reason why it's a checklist and why I'm a proponent of checklists. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite books that I read recently is called The Checklist Manifesto by Atul Gawande. And yeah, he's a surgeon, or I guess now an author and what he did is he did a study of in a hospital in Boston. And they looked at how they were able to use checklists in their operating rooms. And by doing that, they were able to reduce the number of deaths and complications related to surgery. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're not talking about life and death here with using checklists for retirement planning. But, you know, by using one, you can definitely improve the quality of life that you have in your retirement.
Oh, yeah. No, as a coach, Marc, I am as a coaching consultant for small businesses, I absolutely believe and love checklists because there's another psychological component that a lot of people don't think about. When you are able to mark something off your list, you put that check in the box or you draw that line through that item that you accomplished, there's scientific proof that endorphins are released into your system and you get this good feeling of, hey, I have taken care of that. And you want to talk about reducing stress. That's a huge thing for reducing stress when you're able to say, okay, I've gotten this done. Now what's next?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I agree. They're definitely great. And they're applicable in a lot of areas of, you know, personal finance. Mm-hmm, I think we did a 4-part series, episodes 3 to 6, which was just covering a year-end financial planning checklist. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that covered one aspect of it. This, you know, today we're going to look at a checklist that, you know, you should go through prior to retiring.
Okay. When you say prior to retiring, what are you looking at here? Give us a kind of a time frame of years, right? Are we talking, you should start this checklist when you're 55, when you're 60, when you're 40?
So I'll always say when it comes to anything related to financial planning, the earlier you start, the better. Although it may not be practical for some of the items that we're going to cover in the checklist, you may not be practical to start thinking about them at age 30 or age 40. Mm-hmm. This is really, you know, you're coming close to flipping the switch to, you know, making that decision to retire. And, you know, it's as close to that time as possible. So if it's your 60s, mid 60s, or even if you're 70 and are going to, you know, think about retiring. So it's kind of a late stage right before you're about to retire.
Got it. All right. Where do we start?
Okay. So the checklist is broken down into different areas. And the first one is cash flow. So first thing you want to do is look at, will your cash flow needs change in retirement? And if they will, you should really look at developing a new income and expense plan.
All right. So what are the differences in cash flow needs in retirement compared to how we're living today?
So I think the biggest change would be in healthcare expenses. And obviously, you know, when you retire, some expenses are going to go up and some expenses are going to go down. Mm-hmm. You may, you know, be traveling more. You may, you know, not have the same work-related expenses of gas, travel, you know, commuting, but healthcare really, really usually comes or turns out to be the biggest change in expense. And, you know, Fidelity did a study a while ago where they calculated that the average couple will spend about $200,000 in out-of-pocket medical expenses during their retirement. So I think that's where we're going to see, you know, we'll see the biggest change.
Yeah, that's a very, very large change that you've got to plan for.
Yeah, and there's different aspects to that. And one of the sections is in this checklist is healthcare. So we'll actually go into more detail on healthcare in a minute.
All right.
But the next one you want to look at is, will you receive a pension? So I know pensions, for the most part, have gone the way of the dinosaur, but there are still companies and governments and municipalities that do offer pensions. So you really want to look at what your payout options are and how do you coordinate that pension between Social Security and the other assets that you've accumulated. Mm-hmm. So the other thing too with not just pensions, but also, you know, retirement accounts or 401ks, you want to look at if you have a pension or a 401k from another employer that you may have lost track of.
How do people lose track of pensions or 401ks? I mean, if I knew I had a pension or a 401k, I'd make sure that I knew exactly where that was at.
Yeah, you would think so, but I come across this a lot where, you know, it'll be years and someone will discover, oh, I didn't realize I had a, you know, either a pension or a 401k at a previous employer. And, you know, some of the scenarios that could happen are, you know, this could be 20, 30 years ago that you had this pension or 401k. You could have moved a couple times. So you haven't been receiving statements, or maybe, you know, you turned them on to electronic statements and they started just going to spam and it just dropped by the wayside. Mm-hmm. You didn't realize it. And at some point, lucky enough, you do realize it, or hopefully you think about it and realize it, and then there is a way to track it down and, you know, figure out what your options are with it.
Got it.
The other, you know, next thing you want to consider about cash flow is if you're retiring early. And the word early could mean a couple of things, but for Social Security purposes, you want to look at if you're retiring before your full retirement age, which, dependent upon when you're born, is either 66 or 67. And why that's important is that if you do retire before that age, and if you, let's say, you know, I think retirement nowadays is a little bit different in that it's less of flipping the switch than it's more of a transition. So some people do work part-time in retirement. However, if you work and are collecting Social Security benefits prior to your full retirement age, the government's going to withhold some of those benefits because they say, okay, you're still working. You don't need all of these Social Security mm-hmm. benefits. Mm-hmm. The other thing to consider with retiring early, collecting Social Security, is that you actually get, it's basically a penalty that you get if you start collecting your benefits before your full retirement age. So your actual monthly Social Security benefit is reduced if you do not wait until your full retirement age. So you can start collecting as early as 62, but for every year prior to 66 or 67, there's a reduction in benefits.
Gotcha. So that could make a big, huge difference in the rest of the retirement time.
Correct. Yeah. It actually doesn't, it, you're stuck with that. If you start collecting early and are have that reduced benefit, there's no, you know, okay, there's no step up, you know, once you hit your full retirement age, you're stuck with that reduced benefit.
That's a permanent decision you've made.
Exactly. Yeah. It's a permanent decision. One thing that's not well known is that you may have if you do retire early, you may have the ability to access your 401k penalty free if you leave your employer at age 55.
At 55?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I thought it was 59 and a half. And if you withdrew before that, then there was penalties or that you would have some sort of fees.
Yeah. So generally that's true. If you withdraw your funds prior to age 59 and a half, you would incur a 10% penalty and you'd have to pay tax on the distribution. So you're never going to get around not having to pay tax on the money you take out of the 401k. But you may have that opportunity to not have to pay that penalty. Hmm. And the way that works is there'll be two criteria that you need to meet to be eligible for that. And the first one is that you're no longer employed by the employer who you have your 401k affiliated with. And then the second one is that you left that employer during the calendar year in which you reached age 55. So it's a little bit of a way to access your 401k prior to 59 and a half. And there's cons of doing that. You know, the benefit of your 401k is that it's tax deferred and you want it to last the rest of your life. So you also have to look at, if I did start drawing from it at age 55, how would that impact how long that 401k lasts? Mm-hmm. Next thing you want to look at on cash flow is if you're currently married. And for this, we're going to go back to the Social Security topic, but there are different claiming strategies that are out there that really cover or give you options on how you can maximize benefits between someone collecting their own benefits and then their spouse collecting spousal benefits or their own benefits.
And I know we did a podcast about Social Security. I mean, I think it was one entire podcast about Social Security a while ago, and people can go back and listen to that. Has anything changed between the time we had that podcast and now?
I don't know if things have changed recently within the past couple of years with Social Security claiming strategies. There were a couple of strategies that were considered loopholes. Some people are grandfathered into those mm-hmm. strategies. And then for younger folks, some of those strategies are no longer available. So, like you said, the podcast is a great way to get some more detail on what strategies are out there and, you know, what people should be thinking about when they do decide to start collecting.
Gotcha. And they can go to your website, right? And find those podcasts.
Yeah. The podcasts are at BautisFinancial.com or there's a website, agentofwealth.com, that has all the podcasts as well.
Yeah. So if you have not heard that podcast, or maybe this is your first podcast that you're listening to, go check out the website, see all the podcasts we've already done. Marc covers a tremendous amount of information, and the podcast about Social Security, he really dove deep into those different strategies and rules.
The next area we're going to cover are health insurance issues. You know, it's sort of similar on this. Are you planning to retire early? But you may have to make up a gap between when you're eligible for Medicare. So you're not eligible for Medicare until age 65. So you have to look at, will I still be if I retire and leave my employer, will I still be covered mm-hmm. by their health insurance plan, or do I have to figure out another option?
Yeah, I mean, if somebody's retiring at 60, you've got a 5-year gap there. What do you do?
So I think the most common thing that someone does is they're going to look on the health insurance exchanges and look for basically a personal or family policy. Mm-hmm. That's really the best thing to do now, because you don't have that option of start going on to Medicare until you hit age 65.
So is there a time frame? Should they be doing this 2 years before they retire, or is it something where as they're retiring, you know, just a couple months is plenty of time to plan? I mean, I'm imagining that if they're going to go to a private company, that they're going to have to go through some, maybe they'll have to have a physical or some blood work done or whatever. How long does that take?
Yeah. So my recommendation is to really, you know, start this process a year out. And I've helped people go through this. And a lot of times the sticker shock on what a private health insurance policy costs is surprising to a lot of people. You know, especially when you're talking, if you still have dependents at home and there's still a family, you know, if you're insuring four people, five people, it can be a significant increase from what you're used to paying at your employer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I bet.
Yeah. So you also, you know, want to look at, will you need, you know, in addition to just looking at the health insurance, you also want to look at what additional insurance do you need? Vision, dental coverage. And like I said, you start adding all those things up and, you know, it becomes a significant amount of money that, like you said, if you're retiring at 60, that you have to cover up until age 65.
Got it. So if you are retiring after 65 and you've got Medicare coverage, can you still use your HSA?
You can. So HSAs are one of my favorite financial tools and applicable to health insurance, but you really get a triple tax benefit for contributing to one. And they're great at any age to start, mm-hmm. to start contributing to an HSA. But the answer is yes. So you can still use your HSA and it can pay for your Medicare expenses. It can pay for basically any qualified medical expense, including Medicare coverage. So you don't have to, you know, go into or think about retirement as, okay, if I do that, I'm going to lose the ability to use my HSA. You'll still be able to use your HSA in retirement.
Got it. Okay.
The next thing that I think related to Medicare that's surprising is if you look at your income, and if it's over a certain amount, which comes out to $85,000 if you're single or $170,000 if you're married and filing jointly, you may be subject to a Medicare surcharge, which is basically just the government saying you earn a lot of money, you're going to pay extra for your Medicare. So now what that means or how to plan for that is you just want to look and see, is there any way to reduce my income so that I don't, you know, come over that criteria of being hit with that surcharge. Mm-hmm. So it's just a planning opportunity to look at.
Yeah.
And then the final thing on the health insurance side that you want to look at, has any of your needs for life insurance changed? So life insurance used for a variety of reasons, but one of the main ones is to protect your income. Mm-hmm. So you're while you're working, you know, if someone's dependent on the income that you bring in, you want to have a life insurance policy. Now that you're retired, there still are reasons why having life insurance makes sense, but you want to look and still make sure that your scenario falls under one of those situations where it still makes sense to have your life insurance policy.
Yeah, and I know we've talked about strategies with life insurance before, but is there really a need for a lot of life insurance in retirement, more than maybe just covering the basic, not to be morbid, but you know, my burial, right? If I'm going to die, we know that funerals are going to cost a lot. So maybe I'm going to get a policy that's 50 grand just to make sure that I can get buried and my wife can throw a big party.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the answer is yes and no. So there are definitely some reasons to have life insurance in retirement. Using life insurance as a retirement asset is a strategy. So if someone has built up a permanent policy with cash value over, you know, a long period of time, they have that ability to use the cash that it built up, because they not necessarily have that dependency on the death benefit. So mm-hmm. now they can start using the cash buildup. It's also a good vehicle for paying estate taxes. So if someone is going to get hit with the federal or state estate tax, it's a liquid access of funds to be able to pay for that. So there are some benefits for having a life insurance policy in retirement. You just have to, you know, look at it and just make sure it makes sense for you.
Yeah, I would think it's going to be individualized, and that's a great conversation to have with a professional. I don't think anybody should be making that decision just purely on their own, because there are so many options, so many ways to do it that will greatly impact the rest of your family in a positive way by utilizing insurance in the ways that it was meant to be used.
Right. Yeah, no, definitely. It's definitely worth having that conversation.
All right, Mark, another question for you. Just out of curiosity, I just don't know the answer. If you have a life insurance policy and maybe it's a certain number of years that it's active for, and you're retiring and there's 5 years left on your insurance contract, or you're what the life of the insurance is supposed to be, how do you get out of that if you don't want that insurance anymore, or you don't need it anymore?
So the easiest way is you just stop paying the premium. The way the life insurance contract is set up is you have your contract once you initiate the policy, but you're covered by the insurance company as long as you pay the premium. But if you stop paying the premium, you're no longer covered by the policy. And dependent upon what type of policy you have, it could mean different things. If it's a term life insurance policy, it's very straight cut where, you know, you stop paying the
premium. It just stops, yeah.
Okay.
It just ends, right? Yeah. I mean, the insurance just ends if it's term, but what if you have cash built up in the policy?
So that's where it gets a little more complicated, and you just want to look at what your options are. You could stop paying the premium and just take all the cash out. You could use the cash in there to pay the premium so that it just extends the years that you have the policy. So, mm-hmm. you know, you have different options, and depending upon what you need or what you're looking to do with it, you could either extend it or make that clean break from the policy.
Yeah. And obviously, you know, when you're younger and you have children, your policy may be higher because you need to replace your income and take care of the kids and make sure your spouse is taken care of. And you consider all these things when signing up for insurance to begin with. But as I'm in retirement and my kids have moved out of the house, I don't necessarily want my wife to have a huge policy on me because there's just too much incentive for her to have a really nice party or a yacht. Right. So I just want to make sure it's covered for what she needs. And then hopefully if we've done a good job of retirement planning, then she's not going to need a huge payout, you know, when I kick it. So those are my thoughts, Mark. I don't know if anybody else thinks that way, but I love my wife and I trust her, but you just never know, right?
That's true. And kind of to what you're saying is you actually, you know, you don't have to have that clean break where you just get rid of the policy. You could actually have a decreasing death benefit.
Okay.
So if your needs do change and, you know, you have your mortgage paid off and kids are out of school, out of the house, and the need for having that, you know, blanket there if something does happen is less, you could actually reduce the amount of the death benefit and still keep some of the policy in place.
Yeah. And I think that's another really important thing that you need to consider is that if you have a policy that has cash value in it, you may not need that life insurance anymore, but you certainly may need that cash that's in the policy for some long-term care stuff or for medical costs, like we were talking about earlier. $200,000. I mean, that study that you quoted, $200,000 in retirement, that's huge. A lot of people are like, hey, if I've got $200,000 to retire on, I'm pretty okay. Well, we pretty much know that that's not quite right. And now that we know that, you know, medical costs could be $200,000 just in retirement, that, I mean, that's a huge hit to a lot of people's thoughts as far as what they're going to retire on.
Yeah, a lot of the thinking is, okay, I'll turn 65, I'll go on Medicare, and I'll never have to pay a medical expense again. And unfortunately, that's not the case. There are still co-pays, co-insurance, deductibles, different plans and supplemental plans and Medigap policies and long-term care, potential need for long-term care. So there is a, you know, even though you are retiring and you're going on Medicare, there are still a lot of potential costs that you'll, you know, potential healthcare costs that you'll have in retirement.
Yeah. And I know we went down a rabbit hole here, Mark, and I appreciate you indulging my questions. I know we've got more to cover in this topic alone. Can we do a second podcast to continue this conversation?
Yeah, definitely. I think the areas we have left, we have asset and debt issues to look at, tax planning issues, and then long-term planning issues. So you start looking at, you know, what's best for your estate. So yeah, I agree. I think it definitely makes sense to do a follow-up podcast on this.
All right. Fantastic. Any closing thoughts for what we've talked about today?
No, I think, you know, we covered the first half of what people should be thinking about when it comes to retirement. And the next one, we'll look at the second part of it.
All right. And those that are listening, I don't want you to wait to the second podcast to get your questions answered. If something in this podcast sparked a question in you and you have concerns or thoughts or something that we said didn't sit right with you and you're like, I need to clarify that, you just need to reach out to Mark and his team. Amazing group of people to work with. Mark, where can they reach you?
Best way is if you go to my website, bautisfinancial.com. It'll have all my contact info. There'll also be a link to schedule a free consultation.
Fantastic. Can you spell Bautis for us?
Sure. It's Bautis.
Bautisfinancial.com. All right. Thank you so much, Mark, for your time today, and I look forward to the next podcast.
Thanks, Mark.
All right. And thank you all for listening to the Agent of Wealth podcast with Marc Bautis. If you have not subscribed to the podcast yet, please click the subscribe now button below. This way, when Mark comes out with a new podcast, the next one especially, it'll show up directly on your listening device. It makes it much easier to share these podcasts with your friends and family. Again, thanks for listening today. For everyone at Bautis Financial, this is Eric Johnson reminding you to live your best day every day, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you for listening to the Agent of Wealth podcast. Click the subscribe button below to be notified when new episodes become available. The information covered and posted represents the views and opinions of the guest and does not necessarily represent the views or opinions of Bautis Financial. The content has been made available for informational and educational purposes only. The content is not intended to be a substitute for professional investing advice. Always seek the advice of your financial advisor or other qualified financial service provider with any questions you may have regarding your investment and financial planning.